Okay, guys, good morning, everyone. As most of you are here in the class, we can start. So let's just start remembering a little bit of what we did last class, okay? So can you remember what did we talk about last class? What was the grammar? Can you remember? What was the topic last class? Can you remember? You have a clue over there. Ya tienen una pista ahí en su pantalla.
Used to.
We were talking about used to and usually, right? We were talking about some past habits and some present habits. Cuando nosotros vamos a hablar de hábitos presentes, ¿no? Decíamos que íbamos a ocupar el usually o cualquier otro verbo de adverbio de frecuencia, ¿no? Normally, usually, always, etcétera, etcétera. Pero si estamos hablando de past habits, we are going to use this used to. No nos olvidemos que este used to lo ocupábamos cuando o hacemos referencia a una actividad o una acción. ¿Sí? Something, an activity or an action that you used to do and you don't do it anymore. So something you did but in the past, let's see, something in the past, and you don't do it anymore. Or it can be also the opposite, something you didn't used to do, and now you do it, right? So we can play with the possibilities here with these past habits. Si tenemos dos opciones, ¿no? Con este used to. Si ustedes utilizan el used to de forma afirmativa, tal como está aquí, nos referimos a algo que generalmente no hacía o que nosotros solíamos hacer en el pasado. Sí, por ejemplo, qué sé yo, ir al parque a jugar en la resbaladera o cosas así, algo que solíamos hacer y que ya no lo hacemos ahora en el momento actual. ¿Sí? Ese sería el uso de este used to. O también si ustedes ocupan la forma negativa, recuerden que podría ser didn't used to. En este caso, se estarían ustedes refiriendo a algo que ustedes no hacían en el pasado, pero que tal vez hoy ya lo hacen. I can remember some of you did very good examples. For example, I didn't used to go to the gym, but now I go to the gym, right? So this is also a good example. So it would be something or any activity you didn't used to do, but now you do. Okay, so something you didn't used to do in the past, now you do. That's the use of this past habit word, used to or didn't used to, ¿no? Para eso vamos a ocupar, no nos olvidemos el didn't used to o el used to. ¿Qué pasa con los hábitos que tenemos en la actualidad? Es decir, lo que hacemos hoy en día, the present habit. what happens with this? You are going to use, it's very common to listen the use of usually. I told you last class, you can also use normally. And you can also use any other frequency adverb. Remember the frequency adverbs that we used to see in first level. So you can use any of them when you're talking about present habits. Sí, cuando estamos hablando de hábitos presentes, podemos usar cualquiera de los adverbios de frecuencia. Okay, frequency adverbs. But it's very common for you to listen or to see the use of usually or normally, okay? You can also use any other frequency adverb, maybe sometimes, often, always, never, rarely, any of them you can use. And these present habits, it's you're going to use them when you're talking about what you do now, what you or any action you repeat in the present tense. For example, I always or I usually go to the market every Friday, let's say. Sí, yo generalmente voy al mercado todos los viernes, ¿no? O los viernes. Es una forma de presentar acciones o algo rutinario, hábitos o rutinas del momento presente. So, don't forget the use of these ones, and we're going to see if you remember what I'm just telling you by solving some sentences, okay? So, I'm going to ask some of you to help me completing the following sentences. Look at the chart and help me completing these ones, okay? So, you're going to choose, rather, if we're going to use used to or maybe usually in these sentences, okay? So pay attention to which one should we use, used to or usually. And the first sentence, can you help me with the first one, please? Tupac, how would you complete the first sentence?
Yes, teacher.
Mm-hmm. Can you help me, please, with number one? ¿Cómo nos quedaría la número uno, Tupac? Utilizando used to or usually.
Some.
Mm-hmm.
And usual?
Are you sure?
Sam used to when there was a storm, but
ojo que tenemos que verbos que están en entre paréntesis, ¿no?
So, yes.
Sam used to panic.
Panic when there was a storm, but nowadays he. Usually stay calm.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. So nowadays he usually stay calm. Thank you, Tupac. So this would be the answer for this first sentence. So we have. Sam used to panic when there was a storm, but nowadays he usually stays calm. No se olviden en, sorry, I wrote it bad. Cuando ustedes estén utilizando usually o cualquier otro frequency adverb, recuerden que son hábitos del presente y en el tiempo presente. Cuando hablamos de he, she o it, el verbo iba con la S o ES al final. ¿Sí? No nos olvidemos de ese pequeño detalle. So let's move to number two. Can you help me, please, Steffi, completing number two? ¿Cómo nos quedaría? My grandmother. ¿Cómo nos quedaría la número dos?
Can I help you, teacher?
Okay, just give me a second then. Steffi, can you hear me?
Teacher.
Steffi, yes. Tú, mientras me ayuda a su número dos, tú prepara la número tres.
Okay, teacher. Excuse.
Okay, thank you. Entonces, Asu, can you help me with number two, please?
All right. My grandmother didn't use it to send internet messages, but now she usually sends messages. Give me a second. I can see, yeah, messages every day.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. So, yes. My grandmother, en este caso tenemos una oración con negativo, ¿no? Didn't. My grandmother didn't use to
send
internet messages. But now she usually sends, thank you, Asu, usually sends, no nos olvidemos de la S al final, she usually sends messages every day. Thank you. Look at this. Mi abuelita antes no enviaba mensajes por internet, pero ahora ella generalmente envía mensajes todos los días, ¿no? Let's see, Steffi, can you help me with number three, please?
I use it to stay late at night, but now I usually go to bed at 10.
Mm-hmm, exactly. So I used to stay up late at night, si yo generalmente o yo usualmente solía quedarme despierto hasta muy tarde en la noche, pero ahora, but now, I usually go to bed at 10 p.m. Si ahora usualmente voy a la cama o voy a dormir a las 10. Thank you, Steffi. Can you help me with number four? Anybody? Someone who wants to help me with number four?
When John was younger, he used to like rock music, but nowadays he usually prefers listening to jazz.
Mm-hmm, exactly. Thank you. That was perfect. So, when John was a younger, he used to like. Cuando John era joven, a él solía gustarle la música rock, ¿no? But nowadays he usually prefers. Listening to jazz. Escucha jazz ahora. No. So let's move to number five. Can you help me, please, Marjorie, with number five?
Peter used to ride his bike after school, but last year he usually played football.
Are you sure? Me dices, ojo, yo solo leo lo que me dices. Peter solía manejar su bicicleta después de la escuela, pero el año pasado él usualmente juega fútbol. Does it make sense? How would it be? Can somebody else help me, please?
Teacher, in this sentence, Peter usually writes his bike after school, but last year he used to play football.
Exactly, thank you. So, but last year he used to... En este caso, miren, no todo va a ser como las cuatro primeras oraciones, ¿no? No todas van a ir primero el used to y después el usually. Be very attentive, be very careful with the tenses. Acuérdense que el used to era para hábitos en el pasado. Miren qué tenemos aquí. But last year. Y nos dice, pero el año pasado... Entonces, si estamos hablando del año pasado, vamos a ocupar el used to para referirnos al hábito o a la acción que hacíamos en el pasado. Okay, so this is basically why here we're going to use used to in the second part of the sentence. So, what about this one, number six, my parents. Who can help me with this one, my parents?
Hi, teacher.
Okay, help me, baby.
My parents didn't used to play computer games, but now they usually do it every night.
Exactly. My parents didn't used to play computer games, but now they usually do it every night. So... Usually do it every night. So yes, thank you. En este caso volvemos nuevamente al uso del used to al inicio. ¿Por qué? Porque en la segunda, para conectar con la segunda cláusula o la segunda parte de la oración, miren, aquí tenemos un but. But now, pero ahora... Sí, y estamos hablando del presente, por lo tanto, en el siguiente espacio vamos a llenar con el usually que nos permite hablar de present habits. Let's complete just one more sentence and I think we're done. Can anybody help me just with number seven?
Me, teacher. Me, teacher.
Okay, I have two students. So, we're going to do seven and eight, okay? Marjorie is going to help me with seven and Vane with eight, okay?
Okay, teacher.
Okay, Marjorie, come on.
We usually drive to work, but last year we used to take the bus.
Exactly. Now we have again this change, right? So we usually drive. We usually drive to work. Usualmente manejo al trabajo, pero el año pasado, I used to take, or we used to take. El año pasado solíamos tomar el bus. So yes, that's the answer. Thank you, Marjorie. Let's continue with number eight. Vane, can you help me?
Yes, teacher. Susan and I didn't used to meet very often, but nowadays we usually have lunch twice.
So Susan and I didn't used to meet very often. Susan y yo no solíamos vernos con tanta frecuencia, but nowadays, pero hoy en día, es decir, en la actualidad, no. Nowadays, we usually have lunch twice. But we usually have, ¿ok? Pero ahora usualmente, pero ahora sí, usualmente almorzamos dos veces a la semana o al mes, no lo sé, pero dos veces almuerza, ¿sí? We have lunch twice. Thank you, guys. So here we have, as you can see, the example of last grammar and the use of used to and usually. When you want to talk about any past habit or any present habit you have. Okay, so now I'm going to give you some questions, guys. Think about the answers, the possible answers, and as soon as you have your answer, please raise your hand or tell me, teacher, I want to talk, okay? So today we will be covering unit 3C and 3D because next week, as you know, is our midterm exam. We're around the corner to complete the half of the English level. So let's think about these questions, guys. When was the last time you bought a present for a friend or a relative? Can you remember when was the last time you bought something for somebody? Can you remember? When was the last time you bought a present or a gift for a friend or a relative? Can you remember what did you buy? What was it? And try to remember if the person you give the present like it. Did he or she or them like it, the present? We're going to think about these three first questions, okay? So I'm going to ask some of you about these three questions. When was the last time you bought a present for a relative or a friend? Can you help me with the answer, please, Aldrich? When was the last time you bought something for a friend or a relative or a girlfriend?
A week ago.
Okay, a week ago.
For my girlfriend.
What was it?
¿Cómo se dice pijama?
A pijama, pijamas.
A pijama.
Okay, so it was a week ago, right? Did she like it or not?
Yes, she liked it.
Mm-hmm. Pijama. And yes, she liked it. Okay, so you know what she likes. That's good. You're going through the good way. Okay. Somebody else, let's see. Kevin, when was the last time you bought a present for a friend or a relative?
Yes. The last time I bought something from my friend was last year.
Okay, last year. What was it? What did you buy?
I bought a mouse for his computer.
Okay, a mouse for his computer. Excellent. Did he like it or not?
Yes, he liked me a lot because he needed it.
He needed. Okay, excellent. So you are good listeners or good observers because you know what your friends or relatives need. Thank you. And let's listen to the last one. Erika Chuga, can you help me please with these questions? When was the last time you bought a present or a gift for a relative or a friend? The first one. Yes.
When was the last time you bought a present for a friend or relative? I bought a gift a month ago for my younger brother because he was turning 17 years old.
Wow, what did you buy to him? What was it? What was the gift? ¿Qué le compraste?
A soccer ball, because he likes sport a lot.
Okay, a soccer ball. So I assume that he likes it, right? ¿Le gusta el regalo?
Yes, because he's a fan of sport. Yes.
Yes, he's a fan of sports. Thank you. Thank you. Yes. So thank you for helping me answering these questions. Now I'm going to ask you two more. Do you buy things online? And what do you usually buy online? So let me see. Let me see my next victim. So Santiago Mejia, can you help me with these two questions? Do you buy things online?
La 4 y la 5, ¿verdad?
Yes. ¿Compras algo o cualquier objeto en internet? Do you buy things online?
No. I don't buy things online.
No, okay. You don't buy things online. Not even food, because now we're asking some food through internet. Remember, with the pandemic, this has become something normal. Ahora ya es más usual, ¿no? Hacer compras en internet o al menos pedir comida, ¿no? Usando internet. So, thank you, Santiago. Can you help me with your answer, please? Let me see. Carlita, help me answer in number 4 and number 5. Do you buy things online?
Yes, I do. I buy things online. I buy the clothes.
You buy the clothes? Okay. So that's something new. You buy clothes online. Thank you. Let's see somebody else. Let me ask this one to Diana. Do you buy things online, Diana?
Okay. No, I doesn't.
Ojo, cuando estén respondiendo como no, yo no compro algo, no, I don't. No, I
don't. Sorry, teacher.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so I have some people who don't trust buying things on internet and some others that have bought some stuff on internet. That's quite interesting. Okay, so let's see what we have for today, guys. As you can see, guess what is the topic about? We're going to talk about some gifts, maybe, or some presents that we're going to buy for somebody else. So, look at the following picture and watch out these words we have in the box. And try to guess what a story do you think Mark is telling to Tom? ¿Qué historia creen ustedes que Mark le esté contando a Tom de acuerdo con las palabras del juego de palabras que tenemos en esa cajita? Think about this, guys. You're going to have 2 minutes to think about an answer and I will ask you very soon, okay? So think about the answers. Vayan pensando en las respuestas. What do you think or what the story will Mark be telling to Tom? Can you guess what are they talking about? So, can you help me with the answer for this short question, please, Robert? What story do you think Mark is telling to Tom?
Yes, I think they are talking about maybe a person that Mark have to buy to his dad, and mm-hmm. they maybe will have a celebration with the children.
Thank you, Robert. Yes, that's our very good guessing, I think, because you are using all the words we have on the box. Thank you, excellent. So, according to, and after you analyze or you saw this picture, we're going to see a video. We're going to see a video and we will try to complete this sentence. What mistake did Mark made, okay? What mistake did Mark made? ¿Cuál fue el error que cometió Mark? So pay attention to the video and help me with the answers, okay? So let me share the screen with you so you can see the video. And also I will share down so everybody can listen, okay? So pay attention to the first part of the video and help me with the answer. What did Mark, or what was the mistake that Mark did, okay? ¿Cuál será el error que cometió Mark? Let's listen, guys.
Hi, Mark. Hi, Tom.
Hi, Paula. Hi. We're still meeting at 10, right?
Yes, we are. We're in meeting room 3, I think. See you in there.
Yep, see you in a minute.
Coffee?
Yes, please.
So, did you have a good weekend?
It was good, thanks. But you won't believe what I did.
What?
Remember I told you my dad wanted a desk for his new office, and I offered to help him find one online?
Oh, yeah?
Well, I found one. It looked perfect. Exactly what I was looking for. It was a fantastic price, too.
Sounds good.
Exactly. So I ordered it.
Great.
And it arrived on Saturday. But the funny thing is, it was really, really small.
How small?
It only came up to my knees.
Hey?
It turned out I'd ordered a desk for a child.
No way!
Mm-hmm. I forgot to check the measurements on the website.
Oh, so what did you do?
Okay, guys, so can you guess what was Mark's mistake?
The desk for the father is very small.
Mm-hmm. The desk he ordered for his father was too small. What did he forgot? ¿De qué se olvidó? The desk was too small because he forgot.
He forgot to check the measurements.
Yes. He forgot to check the measurements in the web page. Yes, this is something common when you are buying or ordering something online. Sometimes you see a picture, you think that it's going to be perfect, but when the product arrives, something happens, right? So that's why you need to be very sure or to check everything when you are ordering online. So yes, the measurements were not the ones that he wanted for his desk. The desk probably was too small, maybe for children. So that was the mistake. Thank you, guys. Let's see. So in this unit, you're going to see some expressions you can use in order to react to what people say. When people is giving you some good news, some bad news, or something surprising, you can use some specific phrases or words that can help you to sound a little bit more likely to people. For example, here we have some phrases. And we're going to match, okay? So I will share you again the phrases, the record. So you can listen and you can help me matching these sentences. Sentence from 1 to 4 to, let me share with you, yes. Yes, you're watching what I'm watching. So you're going to help me matching sentence from 1 to 4 with the reactions from A to D, okay? So here we have some reactions and some sentences. Tenemos reacciones y tenemos algunas situaciones, ¿no? Let's listen then.
Track 1.49, part 1.
Hi, Mark. Hi, Tom.
Hi, Paula.
Hi.
We're still meeting at 10, right?
Yes, we are. We're in meeting room 3, I think. See you in there.
Yep,
see you in a minute.
Coffee?
Yes, please.
So, did you have a good weekend?
It was good, thanks. But you won't believe what I did.
What?
Remember I told you my dad wanted a desk?
So, which one would be with number 1? You won't believe what I did. ¿Con cuál unir?
Be what?
Be, exactly. Be, right? What? Cuando alguien les está dando una noticia o les dicen, adivina qué, o no sabes ni te imaginas lo que hice, o sabes lo que hice, ustedes responden, what? See, you won't believe what I did. So, the answer is what? It was a fantastic prize too. Let's listen what goes with this one. Vamos a escuchar qué iba con esta parte, okay? So listen carefully, guys.
For his new office, and I offered to help him find one online.
Oh, yeah?
Well, I found one. It looked perfect, exactly what I was looking for. It was a fantastic price, too.
Sounds good.
Exactly.
So, after this, it was a fantastic price, too.
Letter C.
Letter C, exactly, guys. Everybody was fine. So, letter C, sounds good. Sí, estamos dando una buena noticia. It was a fantastic prize too. And you answer, sounds good. Thank you. So, let's move to the next one. So, I order it. Let's listen.
So, I ordered it.
Great.
And it arrived.
And what would be after, so I order it.
Letter A.
Letter A. Exactly, letter A. Great. Entonces lo ordené. Genial, ¿no es cierto? Great. It turned out I'd order a desk for a child. Resulta que ordené un escritorio para niños. That is left is letter D. No way. Sí, no te creo. So that would be no way. Thank you. So which of these expressions we have right here are or we can use it in order to respond to something in a positive way? Which of these do you think are going to help us to respond to something in a positive way? For example, let me give you an example. I think we can use great, ¿no es cierto? Letter A, to respond to something in a positive way. Which other phrase can we use?
Sounds good.
Letter C, sounds good. Thank you. So both both phrases can help us in order to answer in a positive way. What about showing surprise?
What?
Letter D. No way. Sí, no te creo. En serio. So this would be like showing surprise. Cuando algo está, alguien está sorprendido de alguien, es no way, la frase correcta. And asking for more information.
Letter B.
Letter B, we're asking for more information. We're saying what? ¿Qué pasó, no? What? So don't forget about these short sounds or phrases because they are going to help us when we want to react to what people say. So for example, here we're going to see some other phrases or other ways we can use in order to react. Let me share with you. As I was telling you before, you can react to what, if somebody says something interesting, you can also say phrases such as really, yes? So both can help us when you are showing surprise or when you cuando alguien les dice algo muy interesante, dicen en serio, no, really? Pero en general en inglés hay algunas frases que nos van a permitir reaccionar a lo que los demás están diciendo, ¿no? For example, if you hear some bad news, si oímos alguna mala noticia, podemos responder como, oh no, right? Oh no, or I don't believe it. Si no puedo creerlo. You're kidding, right? Sí, estás bromeando, ¿cierto? What a pity, qué pena, qué lástima. Never mind, como olvídalo, how fantastic, qué genial, qué fantástico, what a great idea, and that's great news. So here you have some different reactions to what people say, maybe to good news, maybe to bad news, maybe to something surprising. So here we have some different expressions we can use in order to react besides the ones we have seen from the book. Sí, aparte de las que tenemos en el libro. So as I was telling you, when you hear good news, you can react with phrases such as how fantastic, how great, that's great news, that's good news. That's or what a great idea. So these are some phrases you can use when you hear good news. Cuando escuchan buenas noticias, pueden utilizar estas frases. O por el contrario, si tenemos bad news, we can hear or we can use these phrases. Oh no, right? Or what a pity. Or never mind. Yes, so these are going to be for bad news, these phrases. You can also use some phrases when you are surprised by something. Okay, when you hear something surprising, you can say, you're kidding. Cuando es algo que les sorprende, sí, es algo sorprendente lo que les están diciendo y ustedes quieren reaccionar. Podrían ocupar frases como you're kidding or I don't believe it. Okay, so these are some phrases we can use to sound surprised. ¿Sí? Para referirnos a algo sorprendente. Yes. You're kidding. Estás bromeando, ¿sí? Es como que para nosotros suena raro porque generalmente nosotros no decimos, digamos, si yo te digo, Vivi, you have won el pozo millonario. You have just won el pozo millonario. $1,000,000. Te acabas de ganar el pozo millonario. $1,000,000. Y tú dices, estás sorprendida y dices, ¿en serio? No creo, ¿no es cierto? Es como que, no lo puedo creer. ¿Están bromeando? So that's the reaction on, or that's the meaning of this, you're kidding. Ese sería como el literalmente significa estar bromeando, you're kidding. Pero se utiliza para situaciones como esta, ¿no? Si por ejemplo te dicen algo que no puedes creer que sea cierto, ustedes van a decir, you're kidding. Okay, so that's the meaning of this phrase. Eso significa esta frase, estar bromeando. ¿Sí? Si alguien les dice, por ejemplo, después del examen, you got a zero, y ustedes estudiaron toda la noche, dicen, no, ¿yo qué voy a tener cero? You're kidding. Pueden responder, no, you're kidding. Estás bromeando, no es verdad. So, this would be the meaning of this phrase, you're kidding. So here is just a fast review of what I was telling you before. We have some phrases that we use when we, or when something is very surprising. You're kidding, or I don't believe it. When something interesting is being told, cuando les dicen o les cuentan algo interesante, ustedes pueden contestar, really? ¿En serio? Okay, for example, I'm going to move to the US next week. Sí, algo interesante. Me voy a cambiar, me voy a mudar a Estados Unidos la siguiente semana. Alguien me contesta, really? ¿En serio? Sí, sería un ejemplo. When you react to good news, ¿no es cierto? Cuando nos dan buenas noticias, you can say, how fantastic, that's great news, or what a great idea, for example. And on the other side, if you heard some bad news, si escuchamos malas noticias, podemos escuchar, oh no, what a pity, or never mind. Y como posibilidades. Si ustedes observan cuando dan buenas o malas noticias, cuando ustedes reaccionan a buenas o malas noticias, generalmente utilizamos esta estructura que tenemos aquí. How plus an adjective or what plus a noun. ¿Sí? Por ejemplo, aquí ustedes tenían, look at this, how fantastic. Tenemos how más un adjetivo. Podríamos cambiar ese adjetivo por cualquier otro. How great, how awesome, how brilliant. Sí, para reaccionar a noticias buenas o afirmativas. También podríamos utilizarle para reaccionar a alguna noticia mala, ¿no? For example, how awful, how terrible, how bad. Sí, podemos añadir cualquier otro adjetivo para reaccionar, ya sea a buenas noticias o a malas noticias, ¿no? And you can also use what plus a noun to react to bad or good news. Y lo mismo para what. Pero en lugar de ir seguido de un adjetivo, pueden ocupar con un sustantivo. Por ejemplo, here we have, for example, what a great idea, ¿no es cierto? Qué buena idea, what a great idea para oración, para noticias buenas, para reaccionar a noticias buenas. And what a pity para reaccionar a noticias malas, ¿no? What a pity. Qué lástima. Qué pena. Okay, so here we have some phrases we can use in order to react to good or bad news. Can you help me completing these ones, guys? We have here an example. Number one, Kate's going traveling for a year. Kate se va a viajar todo un año. Son buenas noticias, ¿verdad? Por lo tanto, aquí escogemos, miren, what a great idea. What about number two? I've left my wallet at home again. Me olvidé mi billetera otra vez en la casa. What would you answer?
I don't believe it.
Mm-hmm. I don't believe it, podría ser. Or, what else can you say?
You're kidding,
right? Ajá. Es como que ya están a punto de pagar la cuenta y empieza alguien. I left my wallet at home again. Me olvidé la billetera otra vez. You're kidding, right? Estás bromeando. What about number three? I didn't get the job. No conseguí el trabajo. ¿Qué me dirían ustedes? That's great.
What a pity.
What a pity. Qué lástima, qué pena. What a pity. We're getting married. Nos vamos a casar.
Oh, fantastic.
Okay, could be. How fantastic, or what else can it be?
That's great news.
Mm-hmm. That's great news. Son buenas noticias. Qué buenas noticias. That's great news. Okay, so you can use both. What about number five? Dave's got a new car. Dave's got a new car. Dave compró o tiene un nuevo carro.
Really?
Mm-hmm. That's interesting, right? So, really? Really? And the last one, I've lost my phone. Perdí mi teléfono.
Oh, no.
Right? Yes, oh, no. That's terrible. So, these are bad news.
Teacher, excuse me, antes de que pase.
Sure.
En la número cuatro, en caso, bueno, digamos, supongamos en español, ¿no? Si alguien dice nosotros nos vamos a casar y a otra persona de pronto le parece una mala idea, ¿también no podría ser la respuesta oh no?
Yes, it could be oh no. For example, if you know that your best friend is getting married with a guy that is cheating her, is beating her, or is hitting her, you're going to say, oh, no. Yes. Si alguien se va a casar con alguien que no, saben que esa pareja no va a funcionar, que se ponen los cachos al revés y al derecho, que se pegan, que se maltratan, que son tóxicos al 1000%. Of course you can react like that. You can say, oh no, yes. That's a possibility too, yes. Podría ser una posibilidad. You could use it too. Podríamos utilizar también. Thank you for your comments, but yes, that's a possibility. Most of the time it's going to depend on the context, right? Casi siempre va a depender del contexto. For example, you can also say, oh no, for the idea, the first one. También podríamos ocupar, oh no, si sabemos que Kate es una persona que, qué sé yo, que es despistada todo el tiempo, que pierde las cosas todo el tiempo, que confía en desconocidos y que no sabe lo que le va a pasar, ¿no? Entonces, si uno escucha, Kate se va de viaje todo el año, y uno dice, oh no. What a pity, qué pena. No sabemos qué vaya a pasar con Kate, ¿no? Todo depende, va a depender bastante del contexto, de lo que haya detrás de esa noticia que estén ustedes escuchando, porque lo que para unos puede ser buena noticia, para otros no tanta, ¿no? So, yes. Thank you for the observation, but yes, we can use the phrases according to the context. Thank you, guys. So, take some notes of the phrases. Sí, no se olviden de las frases, por ahí apunten las frases. Make a screenshot or maybe make a picture, take a picture of the expressions so you don't forget about them. Here we have a bunch of other phrases. We have phrases such as congratulations, I don't believe it, oh my gosh, that's a pity, what a great idea. You don't say, you're kidding, don't worry about it, keep at the good work, oh no, that's all right, what a surprise. And we can keep on like ordering according to the categories. So here we have three categories: expressing surprise, reacting to good news, or reacting to bad news. We're going to, or I'm going to ask you to give me three phrases for each category, okay? So can you help me with three phrases that can express surprise? ¿Con qué tres frases podríamos nosotros expresar sorpresa?
Really?
Really, okay.
You what?
Mm-hmm.
You're kidding.
Okay, what else?
How fantastic.
Mm-hmm. That how fantastic creo que podría ser para buenas noticias. Si están ustedes o quieren sonar un poco sorprendidos ante una noticia, ¿qué podrían, qué frase utilizarían?
Oh my God.
I don't believe it.
I don't believe it, okay. You have one over there. What a surprise. But yeah, this could be some of the, this one is also a good one. Maybe you don't know the meaning, because if you translate it literally, it's not going to make sense. You're pulling my leg, aren't you? Sí, me estás bromeando, me estás, esta frase, you're pulling my leg, sería el equivalente a me estás tomando el pelo, ¿sí? Eso significaría para nosotros, pero si ustedes le traducen literalmente, no va a tener sentido, es como que me estás tomando la pierna, no tiene sentido para nosotros. Pero el contexto es como que me estás tomando el pelo, ¿no? Me estás bromeando conmigo. You're pulling my leg, aren't you? So, this can also help us in order to show surprise. También nos sirve para mostrar un poco de asombro, ¿no? Sorpresa cuando nos están diciendo algo que no esperábamos. Algo sorprendente. What about reacting to good news? How do you react to good news?
How fantastic.
How fantastic.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Yes, congratulations.
What a great idea.
Oops. Yeah, what a great idea. Here's something about news. That's great news, yes. Son buenas noticias, qué buena idea, felicitaciones, qué fantástico, o qué chévere, o qué bonito, ¿no? So, yes, This could be some of the expressions you can use to react to good news. What about reacting to bad news? ¿Cómo reaccionaría?
Oh, no.
Para las malas noticias, the first one, oh no. What else?
Never meet.
Never mind. Okay.
That's a pity.
That pity, yes.
Oh my gosh.
You can also say yes, oh my gosh. Oh my gosh, what else?
Don't worry about it.
Yes, don't worry about it. Yes, exactly. So this could be some of the phrases we can use when you are reacting to bad news or good news. So thank you for helping me ordering this phrases. So I think I can, or you are ready, so we can move on to the next part. It's more than clear, I think, these phrases. Ustedes ya me han dado algunos ejemplos de estas phrases. Just let's do the last part of this, the last exercise, and let me just come back. Can you, let's move just to this one. Can you look at this picture, guys, and tell me or the answer for this question? What do you think Mark did when he discovered his mistake? What do you think Mark did when he discovered his mistake? Remember that he ordered bad the desk, right? The desk wasn't big enough for his dad. He just asked a small desk for children. So what do you think he did when he discovered his mistake? ¿Qué haría Mark cuando descubrió que se equivocó al pedir por internet? What do you think?
He complained.
Okay, thank you, Wendy. That's a possibility. Maybe he complained with the company. Mm-hmm. Se quejó con la compañía. Puede ser una opción. What else do you think he could do?
He given some consejos, teacher.
Advices. Okay.
Advices are your friends or family.
Mm-hmm. He asked for an advice to some friends or family. That's a good one. Cuando no sabemos qué hacer después de que la arruinamos, ¿no es cierto? Podemos preguntar o pedir consejo a nuestros amigos o familia. Yes. We can ask for advice. Thank you, guys. So we're going to watch another video. And after that video, you're going to help me recognizing if these five sentences are true or false. The first one says the company Mark bought the desk from didn't offer a refund. The second one, sí, la primera sería la compañía donde compró o la empresa donde compró Mark el escritorio no le ofreció un reembolso. That's the meaning of refund, guys. Ese sería el significado de esta palabrita, refund, reembolso. Number two, looking on a free cycling website for a new desk was Rachel's idea. Aquí tenemos, buscar en una página web por un nuevo escritorio es la idea que le dio Rachel. Then we have free cycling is where people can give away unwanted things. Sí, este free cycling o reciclaje libre o gratuito Es donde la gente regala, podría ser, cosas que no necesita o cosas que ya no le sirven. And number four, we have Tom already knew about the website FreeCycle. Vamos a averiguar si Tom ya sabía de la existencia de esta de este website, de esta página web. And the last we have here is Mark is waiting for the desk to be delivered. Mark está esperando a que le entreguen el escritorio. Vamos a ver si son verdaderas o falsas. So, this free cycle que tenemos aquí significa o quiere decir reciclaje, ¿no? Es decir, ofrecer algo, cosas usadas o reciclar algo antes de ya desecharlo o botarlo a la basura. Puede haber alguna página de... en la que se pueden reciclar ciertos objetos, ¿no? Un grupo donde se ofrecen cosas de segunda mano, básicamente. O cosas nuevas que tal vez uno nunca las utilizó, ¿no? So, let's see the video. You're going to watch the video. Pay attention so you can help me with the answers, okay? So, let's change screen. And you're going to help me with the answer. So let's check for the second part of the video.
So what did you do?
Well, I phoned the company to explain and luckily they agreed to give me a refund.
Really? That was very good of them.
Yeah, it was. But anyway, I still had to find a desk. I was looking everywhere, but I couldn't find anything. In the end, Rachel suggested I try one of those free cycling websites.
Free cycling? What's that?
It's where people get rid of stuff they don't want anymore. I'd never heard of it either, but there are a couple of websites for this area. I found the perfect desk straight away, and the best thing is, it's free.
It's free?
Yeah. I think the owner doesn't have enough space for it, so he's just giving it away. So all I have to do is go and pick it up.
Wow. That's good. Are you sure it's the right size this time?
Yeah, I'll double check the measurements this time.
Guys!
Oh, sorry, Paula. It's my fault. I was just explaining to Tom about my desk mix-up.
Okay, guys. So we're going to listen one more time in order you can catch all the answers, okay? So pay attention once again, listen carefully, and let's start.
So what did you do?
Well, I phoned the company to explain, and luckily they agreed to give me a refund.
Really? That was very good of them.
Yeah, it was. But anyway, I still had to find a desk. I was looking everywhere, but I couldn't find anything. In the end, Rachel suggested I try one of those free cycling websites.
Free cycling? What's that?
It's where people get rid of stuff they don't want anymore. I'd never heard of it either, but there are a couple of websites for this area. I found the perfect desk straight away, and the best thing is, it's free.
It's free?
Yeah. I think the owner doesn't have enough space for it, so he's just giving it away. So all I have to do is go and pick it up.
Wow. That's good. Are you sure it's the right size this time?
Yeah, I'll double check the measurements this time.
Guys!
Oh, sorry, Paula. It's my fault. I was just explaining to Tom about my desk mix-up.
So, guys, you heard some interesting information this time, right? So, can you tell me the company Mark bought the desk from didn't offer a refund, or they did offer a refund? What do you think? Is this true or false?
False.
Why? Why do you think it's false?
Porque sí le dieron.
Yes, they did give him a refund. They refund for the their own order, yes. What about number two? Looking on a free cycling website for a new task was Rachel's idea. True or false?
True,
yes, guys, true. Indeed, Rachel was the one who suggested to Mark to look in this website so maybe he could find a new desk. Number three, free cycling is where people can give away unwanted things. Is it true or false?
True.
Okay. Somebody else, true or false? What do you think? What is this free cycling? Yes, guys, this free cycling web page would be a place or a group where people can give away unwanted things. Some of them are in good state, some of them are also. You can get anything somebody else doesn't want anymore for free. Yes, so this is true. Let's move to number four. Tom already knew about this website. True or false?
False.
Why is it false? ¿Ya sabía el amigo de este de esta página?
Él no sabía.
False, yes, he didn't know. He asked, what is it? No, what's that? What's free cycle? So yes, he didn't know. So this is completely false. And the last one we have. Mark is waiting for the desk to be delivered. True or false? ¿Está esperando Mark a que le llegue el escritorio?
False.
¿Qué decía él al final?
Que tiene que ir a retirar.
Ah, tiene que ir a retirar. O sea, consiguió el escritorio gratis, pero tiene que ir a retirar. So he has to pick up the desk. So yes, it's completely false. Thank you, guys. So, we're going to see some other phrases. Vamos a ver un par de frases más. En este caso, just give me a second. I will erase this. And yes, we're going to move on. Look at this. When you're telling some stories or when you're telling something to somebody else, sometimes we tend to use some phrases. In this case, we have, you won't believe what I did, right? You won't believe what I did. No vas a creer lo que me pasó o no vas a creer lo que hice, ¿no? Eso ya nos da pie para saber que una historia o una, aunque sea una pequeña historia, un pequeño relato va a empezar. So you won't believe what I did. No vas a creer lo que hice. Help me completing these six phrases. Right here, sí, me van a ayudar a completar estas seis oraciones, estas seis frases para completar o para empezar a hablar de historias, according to the record that you're going to listen, okay? Van a escuchar ustedes un audio y me van a ayudar a completar esas cinco frases. So, listen carefully, guys, and help me with your answers. Let's see.
Track 1.51. One.
You won't believe what I did.
Two.
The funny thing is, it was really, really small.
So, what's the answer for number two?
The funny?
Funny, that's right, yes. So, the funny thing, lo chistoso es que, o lo gracioso es que, no, the funny thing is that it was really, really small. Lo chistoso, lo divertido de todo esto es que era muy, muy pequeño. Let's continue with number three. Listen, guys.
Three. It turned out I'd ordered a desk for a child.
So, what's the answer of number three? Did you listen it? Listen again, guys. Number three.
Three. It turned out I'd ordered a desk for a child.
What's the answer?
Turned out.
Exactly. It turned out. Resultó. See, it turned out. Let's make it smaller because we have a very small space there. Okay, so it turned out I'd order a desk for a child. Resultó ser que había ordenado un escritorio para niños. Let's listen to number four.
Four. But anyway, I still had to find a desk.
So, but?
Anyway.
Anyway, exactly, anyway. So, but anyway, I still had to find a desk. De todas formas o de todas maneras, igual tengo que encontrar otro escritorio, ¿no? Let's continue with the next one, number five.
Five. In the end, Rachel suggested I try one of those free cycling websites.
What's the answer, Indy?
End.
¿No es cierto? Al final, you know, in the end, al final Rachel me sugirió que intente con una de esas páginas o de esos grupos donde regalan cosas, ¿no? Let's continue with number six, the final one.
Six. I found the perfect desk straight away. And the best thing is, it's free.
Okay, what's the answer? And the
best.
Exactly. And the best thing, it's free. So I found the perfect desk straight away. And the best thing, it's free. So here you have the phrases you can use in order to tell a story. Cuando ustedes quieran contar una historia, pueden utilizar frases como estas. You won't believe what, no vas a creer qué pasó, qué hice, ¿no es cierto? The funny thing is, ojo que este funny también podríamos sustituirlo por cualquier otro adjetivo. The spooky thing is, ¿no es cierto? Lo más... O lo escalofriante es que, o lo divertido es que, ya depende de lo que ustedes estén contando en la historia, ¿no? It turned out. Este se utiliza mucho para contar historias. It turned out that it was false, or the news was false, or something like that. Sí, resultó ser que la noticia era falsa o resultó ser que me olvidé la billetera. It turned out. Sí, resultó ser que it turned out. Pero de todas maneras, anyway, cuando ustedes como que ya quieran ir llegando un poco al final de su historia, in the end, sí, al final, Rachel me dijo que haga esto y me fue bien, ¿no? For example, in the end, Rachel suggested, bla, bla, bla. Y si ustedes quieren resaltar o como darle mayor énfasis a algo, podríamos ocupar la frase que dice, and the best thing is. Y lo mejor de todo es que. Ojo que también podríamos ocupar y lo peor de todo es, ¿no? For example, and the worst thing is, y lo peor es que, sí, podríamos ocupar cualquiera de los dos. And the best thing, or and the worst thing, cualquiera de los dos. Y lo mejor es que, o y lo peor es que. On the right side of your screen, you have some other phrases. Sí, en la parte derecha de la pantalla tenemos otras frases. You have some phrases when you're starting a story. Y cuando empiezan una historia, tienen aquí tres ejemplos de frases. Guess what? You will love this. Did you hear about? ¿Sí? ¿Adivina qué? O vas a amar esto, vas a adorar esto que te voy a contar. Y la tercera, did you hear about? ¿Escuchaste acerca de o escuchaste sobre? Y ya empieza la historia, ¿no? Empieza el chisme. So, to keep the story interesting, para darle o mantener el interés en la historia, podemos añadir frases como las que teníamos, ¿no? It turned out, resultó ser, the funny thing is, ¿sí? Lo gracioso es que, también tenemos aquí esta, guess what happened next, adivina qué pasó después. Or the funniest part was, la parte más divertida fue, ¿sí? Estas frases nos ayudarían como para mantener a la gente interesada en nuestra historia. Returning to the story, si a veces uno como que medio se desvía de la historia, si queremos volver a la historia, ¿sí? Al inicio o a la parte principal de nuestra historia, podemos utilizar frases como anyway, ¿no? De todas maneras, de todas formas, or back to my story. Here we have back to my story. Regresando a la historia. Okay. And you want to end, if you want to end your story, cuando ya queremos acabar nuestra historia, podemos ocupar frases como in the end, que decíamos por acá, in the end, al final, I couldn't believe it, I was so embarrassed, or it was awesome. Sí, tenemos algunas frases para ir ya terminando. Estaba muy avergonzada, si es una historia de algo embarazoso, ¿no? De algo vergonzoso. It was awesome, si fue tal vez una historia de algo, de alguna buena noticia, algo chévere. It was terrible, for example, if it was something bad. Sí, podemos ocupar o jugar con los adjetivos en este caso. So, these are some of the phrases we can use in order to tell a story. For example, here we have add phrases in the list below. I was already giving you the clues. Ya les di las pistas. ¿Qué, cuál de estas frases, en cambio, que tenemos en la parte, en el recuadro rosadito? ¿Sí? In the pink chart, which phrases are or are going to be helpful for us in order to start the story. ¿Qué otra frase ocuparíamos para iniciar una historia? Phrase number one, phrase number two, three, four, five, or six.
The number one?
Mm-hmm. Number one, exactly. You won't believe what I did, right? Number one. I'm sorry, you won't believe. What about adding more information or new information? Which phrases would you use? Para aumentar información, ¿qué frases ocuparía?
But anyway.
Anyway, okay. Number four, what else?
Guess what happened next?
Guess what happened next, yes. What else? Si quieren decir, y resulta que. ¿Cómo dirían? Y resulta que. ¿Qué frase ocuparían?
It turned out.
It turned out, right. It turned out, blah, 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 blah. Yes. What about finishing the story when we want to end the story? Which phrases can we use?
In the end.
In the end, exactly. In the end. Or maybe the best thing is could also be a way to complete or to end a story. So yes, guys, be very careful with the use of these phrases. Write them down. Maybe take a picture or a screenshot, whatever works better for you. And let's see, because we have a bunch of things to do. It's, let me see, what do we have next? So can you, let's see if we have some time to do this activity. But the good thing would be that you think about an interesting thing that happened to you recently. Okay, maybe some mistake, maybe meeting a person, maybe an interesting news, anything that you can think of that can be a good news, bad news, something surprising that you did. We're going to work on this later because we need to move to the next lesson, okay? So we are going to leave it there. If we have a little time, we will come back to this part. Y si tenemos un poco de tiempo, regresamos a esta parte del speaking practice because we need to move to the next lesson, which is lesson 3D, the last part of this unit, okay? So, let's move to the next unit. And now we have two questions, guys. Two questions. The first one, how much do you know about your past or the past generations of your family? How much do you know about the past generations of your family? ¿Qué tan buenos son o qué tanto conocen sobre las generaciones pasadas en su familia? I mean, your grandfathers, maybe your great grandfathers, or maybe if you know about your great great grandparents. So, how much do you know about these generations? Think about that. Vayan pensando, ¿qué tanto conocen sobre las generaciones pasadas de su familia? Tal vez sus bisabuelos, tatarabuelos. You know something about them? ¿Sabemos algo de ellos? Think about it, okay? When you're thinking about question number one, you're also going to think where the context of question number two can be present. Do you know more about your mother's or your father's side of the family? ¿Y sabes más o tienen ustedes más conocimiento de las generaciones pasadas de su familia del lado de su madre o del lado de su padre? ¿De qué lado de la familia tienen más información? ¿De qué lado de la familia saben más? Okay. So think about these questions, guys. We have two questions. And I'm going to ask some of you for the answers, okay? Les voy a pedir a un par de ustedes las respuestas de estas preguntas. It's not so difficult. I will give you my example. Les voy a dar a ustedes mi ejemplo. For example, Janet, can you ask me question number one, please? ¿Puedes preguntarme la número uno, Janetcita?
Okay, teacher. How much do you know about past generation of your family?
Okay, Janet, yes. I know a lot about my past generations, especially of both sides of the family. I come from a very big families, and for example, I know the names and where are my great-great-grandparents from. I know that they came from Spain, from my mother's side of the family, and from my father's side of the family. I also know about my great-great-grandparents that they came from Colombia. So I know that my family is like a mix of cultures, and that would be more or less about my past generations. Diana, can you ask me question number two, please?
What teacher? Do you know more about your mother's or your father's side of the family? Why?
Okay. I know, I think I know the same from both sides of my family, mother's and father's side. Because when I was a kid, I was very interested in listening to my grandparents' stories. So I always was asking about their parents and their grandparents. So when I was at the school, I had a task where I had to ask for or made my family tree. And I could made my family tree until my great-great-grandparents. So that's why I know a lot about my past generations in my family. So guys, this was just my example. Sí, este fue mi ejemplo. Pero en general, sí, en mi caso, me gustaba mucho escuchar las historias de mis abuelitos. Entonces pude armar mi árbol genealógico hasta mis tatarabuelos. And I could know where they come from. Sí, pude saber también de dónde venían, nombres, apellidos. It was like a very huge family tree. Sí, tenía un árbol familiar enorme de lado y lado. So that's what I can say about my family. What about you? Vamos a ver qué me dicen ustedes, qué me cuentan ustedes. Paul, how much do you know about the past generations of your family? Question number one.
When my dad say I only know my grandparents.
Okay.
On my mom side, I even know my great grandmother.
Okay, that's great. So, you know your tus bisabuelitos, ¿no?
¿Conociste mi bisabuela nomás, ajá.
Okay, tu bisabuelita, your great grandmother. Okay.
Y ahí la segunda pregunta es. I know more about my mom's family because they are always talking and we see each other more often.
Okay, yes. You know more about your family side because you see with them more often. That's good. Thank you. So let me see somebody else answer. Thank you, Paul. It was very interesting. So Paul knows to her great-grandmother from the mother's side and from his father's side, just to the grandparents. Let's listen to Christian. Christian, can you help me with your answer of question number one, please?
Yes, teacher. I don't know. I know only my grandma, my grand father's, and no, yes, I meet my great great grandmother. I remember she.
Okay.
The answer of the question too, I don't know, teacher. I don't know. I from where I from.
You don't know where you're from. It doesn't matter, but you know more about your father's side of the family, or maybe you know more about your mother's side of the family.
No, teacher. A ver cómo sería lo que pasa. No soy cercano. ¿Cómo es? I am not close to the family of them, of my mother and my mother, and I don't know.
Okay, yes, that can happen. It doesn't matter. You don't feel close to none of them. You're not so close to any part of the family. Yes, that can happen. Thank you. So it's good that you, sometimes, yes, we don't know where we come from, but we tend to have or to know more information or to have more information about one side of the family. I don't know if, let me see. Yes, Daniel, can you help me with the answer of question number one, please? Yeah, listen.
Do you listen me?
Yes, teacher? I can listen.
Yes, I'm sorry so much. Well, the first, I know a lot the both sides of the generation of my family, my mother and my father. Well, the one side, my mother is, I don't know, the typical family. My grandparents always be married and have a lot of uncles and aunts. But in the side of my father is just a little sad, I thought, because he never was recognized for his father. And I never know it, my grandpa for the side of my father. And I'm sorry so much, the noise. And when I knew it about him, my grandfather, he was very old and he also died in that moment. And was very sad. But I know I have Colombian descension and Ecuadorian for my mother. My father is part Colombian. And that is, I know about my family. It's more large today I can speak.
Yes, because thank you. In the past, families used to be very, very large, right? People used to have a lot of children. So, yes, sometimes that happens. What Daniel said, it can happen. We don't know to all members of the family. And in some cases, we just met them in very sad moments. As when somebody else dies or when things like this happen. So thank you, Daniel, for your answer.
Thank you, teacher.
So I'm going to listen to the last participation. Joanna, can you help me with your answer for the first one, please? Joanna Delgado. Question number one. Wake up, Joanna. If not, Joanna, okay. Can you help me with question number one, please, Grace?
Okay, teacher, I know about past generation in my family, about my mom, my father, and my mom, for example, my grandmother. I know married, but I didn't know my grandfather because he died when I was born. And for example, my father, my grandfather, I didn't know because I have any problems. So the family, my grandmother is very big.
Mm-hmm.
And the second,
number two,
I know the family, my mother's, because I listen to stories or to stories the about the past.
Mm-hmm. You heard a lot of stories of their past. Yes, thank you. So sometimes, yes, we tend to know more about one side of the family. And in other cases, it's very lucky. You're very lucky if you continue to have to your grandparents with you. Most of the time, grandparents let us when we are young or children. So if you have them at home or you have them alive, you need to be or you have to be very thankful for that gift. Grandparents are a gift, definitely. Son una bendición, un regalo a los abuelitos. Si aún los tienen con vida, agradezcan todos los días. I do that because I have my last grandparent alive. Si mi último abuelito está con vida, he has 97 years old. Todavía tengo un abuelito, tiene 97 años y no nos importa escucharle hablar una y otra vez sus historias porque ya a esa edad es lo mejor que uno puede hacer, escucharles, ¿no? So, be thankful with your grandparents, guys. Let's continue with the next. Vamos con lo siguiente. You're going to listen, guys, to a conversation between two people. These people are family. So you're going to listen. If you have your books, you can go to your book because you are going to listen to the next audio, the next record about, look at this. You are going to listen to Brian talking to his cousin, Susie. So here we have a cousin talk about their family. Okay, so let's listen to their record and pay attention because you're going to help me completing some answers. Okay, so let's listen.
Track 1.53.
Yes.
Disculpe por no participar. Es que mi mamá me mandó a la tienda por eso.
Okay, yes, and I also read what you wrote. Sí, escuché lo que leí lo que escribiste también. Thank you. Then I'm going to ask you something else. Ya te pregunto algo más. Be careful with the next listening, guys. Pay attention. Then I'm going to ask you some questions. Okay, so listen, everybody.
It's a shame we don't know much about our grandfather, isn't it? Mom used to love talking about him and Grandma. She always used to tell so many interesting stories about them. But I've got no idea where or when they met.
Yeah. Well, I know he was born in England.
Who, Granddad? Yes, I know. And he wanted to go out and see the world, didn't he? That's why he went to train as a chef, so he could get work on a ship.
What kind of ship?
Cruise ships. And that was before the war. Sometime in the 1930s.
Oh, right.
He loved traveling, and that was the best way to see the world if you didn't have a lot of money back then.
So, how did he meet Gran? She was a nurse, wasn't she? And how did they both end up in Canada?
I don't know. I guess we'll have to do some research.
Okay, guys. Did you listen? Here we have some information about their grandparents, right? They are talking about their grandparents. Están hablando de sus abuelitos. So, what information do we have about their grandparents? ¿Qué información nos dieron de sus abuelitos?
Where they lived.
Okay, where they live, where they used to live. ¿Dónde solían vivir?
England.
In England.
In England. What were they used to do? ¿Qué solían hacer ellos? ¿A qué se dedicaban? This is easy. Can you help me with this one, please? Brandon, what was the occupation or the job or the profession of the grandfather?
They were chefs.
He was a chef. Okay, he was a chef. What about the grandmother, the grandma? What was her profession? Can you help me? Marlon, can you help me with the grandma's profession?
The grandma was a nurse.
Mm-hmm. She was a nurse. So here we have a picture of both of them. Look at this. One was a chef and the other one was a nurse. Thank you. And they say that it was before the war, right? Before the war, antes de la guerra. So the only way you can know the word was becoming a chef and work in a ship, right? Una de las únicas formas en las que las personas antes podían conocer el mundo era convertirse en este tipo de profesiones, ¿no? Ser chef y viajar por el mundo en un barco de crucero. That was
track 1.53.
Sorry, that was one of the possibilities. So now we're going to read an email between these two cousins, Susie and Brian. You're going to help me read it aloud, and we're going to find out why the grandparents decide to live in Canada. Okay, if they were from England, how is that they end living in Canada? Okay, so I'm going to make it bigger so everybody can see and can help me reading the email. Okay, so let me see. Can you please help me reading? Let me see if you're here at the classes. Yes, you're here. Carlitos, can you help me read in the first part of the email, please?
Yes, teacher. Hi, Susie. Hi, I've done a bit of investigation about grand and granddad and how they ended up living in Canada. I told you that granddad worked as a chef on cruise ships from 1937 until 1939, when World War started, and you know that while he was working on one of ships, he met Gran. She was the ship's nurse.
Mm-hmm, exactly. Thank you. So here we have the first part of the email, right? I've done a bit of investigating and grand and granddad and how they end up living in Canada. I told you that granddad worked as a chef on a cruise ship. So cruise ships would mean los cruceros, no? Los barcos de crucero. From 1937 to 1939, when World War II started. And you know that while he was working on one of the ships, he met Granny. Yes, okay, so let's continue with the second part. Let me see. This time I'm going to ask to Alexis. Alexis, can you help me reading the second paragraph, please?
Yes, teacher. Well, apparently, the ship destination was Vancouver. When the ship arrived, they spent a couple of days there. That's when Granddad proposed to Grant, and she said yes. During their stay in Vancouver, they decided that they really liked the city and that they would start a new life in Canada.
Mm-hmm, exactly. So here we have just a few words, you know, a couple of un par de días aquí. Look at this. Here we have. Well, apparently, the ship's destination was Vancouver. Sí, el destino final del crucero era Vancouver. When the ship arrived, they spent a couple of days there. Cuando llegaron, cuando el crucero llegó, decidieron quedarse unos días ahí. That's when Granddad proposed to Gran, and she said yes. Y fue aquí donde el abuelito le propuso a la abuelita, y ella dijo que sí. During their stay in Vancouver, they decided that they really liked the city and that they would start a new life in Canada. Y les gustó el lugar, entonces decidieron quedarse y hacer una nueva vida ahí. Let's see and let's continue with the next paragraph, okay? So, I'm going to ask to... let me see... Wendy, can you help me with paragraph number 3, please?
Yes, teacher.
Mm-hmm.
Listen. However, World War II started and Granddad had to go back to England and join the British Army. Meanwhile, Gran stayed in Canada because it was much safer. They were separated for 5 years and met each other very much. Gran was quite lonely at first, but after a couple of months, she got a job in a hospital and she made friends there. She was only very friendly and good at talking to people.
Mm-hmm, exactly. So, however, the World War II started and the grandfather had to go back to England to join the British Army. Sí, tuvo que regresar y enlistarse en el ejército. That's the meaning of army. Meanwhile, mientras tanto, no se olviden del significado de esta palabra, mientras tanto, ella tuvo que quedarse en Canadá porque era más seguro. Si estuvieron separados for 5 years, they were separated for 5 years and they missed each other a lot. Sí, se extrañaban mucho. Imagínense antes que no había WhatsApp para saber qué era lo que hacían, ¿no? Esperar meses y meses por algo de noticias hasta que llegara una carta. So, after a couple of months, she got a job in a hospital and she made friends. Vemos que la abuelita después de unos años pudo conseguir un trabajo en un hospital y ya tener un par de amigos también, ¿no? Porque pobrecita y solita, sin marido, sin nada, sin saber qué pasaba. So, yes. Let's see what happens next. Vamos a ver qué pasó después. Let me move and let me erase these words and let me move, okay? So we have just two last paragraphs. Can you help me, Brandon, with the next paragraph in 1946?
In 1946, Granddad restored to Canada and they got married. Mm-hmm. Five years later, my father was born, and then 2 years after that, your mother was born.
Mm-hmm. Exactly, thank you. Bueno, aquí ya sabemos que después de los 5 años de la guerra regresó el abuelito, se casaron, nació el padre de uno de ellos y luego nació la mamá, ¿no? So, let's continue with the last part of the email. And this time it's going to help me reading, please. Erika Ramos, can you help me with this one, please?
Sure, teacher. Grand and granddad lived in the same house for 30 years. I used to go and visit them in Vancouver over the summer when I was at the school. Would you like me take you to you to see the house one day? Brian.
Thank you, Erica. So, Gran and granddad live in the same house for 30 years. Sí, los abuelitos vivieron en la misma casa, in the same house, for 30 years. Por 30 años. Solía, dice, yo solía ir a visitarles en Vancouver cuando era verano, ¿no? Over the summer, por el verano. When I was at the school. Cuando estaba en la escuela, en el verano, seguramente en las vacaciones de verano, iba a visitarles a los abuelitos. Would you like me to take you to see the house one day? ¿Te gustaría que te lleve a que veas la casa algún día? It tells us that they no longer live there, right? Nos dice, o por lo que se puede entender entre líneas, parece que ya no viven en la misma casa. Pero la chica que escribe, el chico que escribe el mail, en este caso Brian, le dice, would you like me to take you to see the house one day? ¿Te gustaría que te lleve a conocer la casa algún día? Sí, so here we have some interesting information about family. Tenemos información interesantísima sobre la familia. So, as you heard the record, como ya escucharon ustedes el audio, ¿no? La historia de los abuelitos. Leímos el mail que nos habla más de los abuelitos. Can you tell me why did the grandparents decide to live in Canada? ¿Por qué decidieron vivir en Canadá los abuelitos? Anybody, can you help me with the answer, please?
They really like the city.
Mm-hmm. Because they really like the city, right? They really like the city. And also something else happened at that time. Algo más pasó en ese tiempo. What happened in that time? In 1939.
So according to the context of the world, they decide to stay there because the country was more safe.
Exactly, Robert. You got the right answer. Yes. Because the World War II started, the grandparents thought that maybe Canada could be a safer place to be, right? So they stay there. Thank you. So now, guys, you're going to watch some pictures of these two grandparents, and you're going to help me order the images with the events, okay? So here we have five pictures of these grandparents. Which thing do you think happened first? Which image describes the first thing that happened in their story? ¿Qué imagen describe lo que pasó primero?
Picture B.
Okay.
Letter A.
Letter A or letter B? What do you think?
Letter B.
Letter B.
Exactly. They first met at the ship, right? Remember? Primero se conocieron en el barco, ¿no? No nos olvidemos. They first met on the ship. So letter B would be the first one. Then what happened? Después del...
Letter D.
Thank you. Grandpa had to go to the war, right? Porque irse a la guerra, abuelito. What happened next?
Letter A,
¿no es cierto? Como está, consiguió trabajo en unos y hizo más amigos. So letter A. What about the next?
Letter C, yes.
When the war was over, the grandfather came back to Canada and they got married. And the last thing.
Letter E, exactly.
So this is the whole story in pictures, right? Aquí tenemos toda la historia en imágenes. These are like some of the pictures we used to see in our grandfather or grandparents' house. Si ustedes todavía pueden ir a la casa de sus abuelitos o pueden acceder a las fotos de la familia, no se ven fotos como estas. Solo de los momentos más importantes, porque antes no tenían celular con cámara para tomar fotos de todo. So they used to make pictures just about the most important things in life, right? Solo de las cosas más importantes en la vida tenían pues sus fotos, ¿no? Por ejemplo, del matrimonio, tal vez de donde trabajaban o de alguna salida a algún lugar muy lejano, cosas así. Pictures were very... were like a privilege for some people. Si antes era como un privilegio poder tener muchas fotos. Okay, so here we have some of the life of this family. They are getting to know more information about their grandparents. When you are telling a story, guys, as before, sometimes we need to focus on the tense or on the time. We need to describe the time when things happened. And for these cases, we're going to use some phrases, some specific words that can help us in order to describe the time when we are maybe talking about a story or an anecdote, okay? So, when you want to talk about a period of time or maybe in a specific time in the story, you can use the following phrases. Here we're going to see six phrases, guys, six sentences that are taken from the email. ¿Sí? Estas oraciones son del mail que ustedes me ayudaron a leer. Now, here we have some words in bold. Tenemos algunas palabritas, oraciones que están en negritas. Can you help me, guys? Do they all describe a point in time or a period of time? ¿Qué es lo que describen? ¿Un punto específico en el tiempo o tal vez un periodo de tiempo? Look at this. Look at the sentence.
Period of time.
Okay, a period of time. A period of time. Exactly. So these phrases help us to describe a period of time. Un periodo de tiempo, ¿sí? Por ejemplo, cuando ustedes quieren ser muy específicos, cuando empezó algo y cuando terminó algo y englobar ese tiempo, sí, podemos ocupar estas dos palabritas, from and until, desde y hasta, ¿sí? From 1937 until 1939, ¿sí? Desde este año hasta este año pasó esta situación, ¿no? So we can use these two words in order to talk about a period of time. You can also use while or during. ¿Sí? Podemos ocupar while, mientras, para referirnos qué era lo que sucedía mientras tal cosa pasaba. ¿Sí? So, for example, here we have, while he was working on one of the ships, mientras él estaba trabajando en uno de los barcos, él conoció a la abuelita, ¿no? So, when he was working on the ships, he met Gran. Es decir, o hablamos del periodo de tiempo en el que él estaba o se encontraba trabajando en el barco. The same happens with this word, during. ¿Sí? Durante. Durante su estadía en Vancouver, hablamos de un periodo de tiempo. Es decir, mientras ellos estuvieron en Vancouver, ellos decidieron que les gustaba la ciudad y bla, 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 bla. So, estamos hablando de un periodo de tiempo. We can also talk about a period of time when we use for before any number. Okay, so for example, they were separated for 5 years. Estuvieron separados por 5 años. Este por generalmente puede ir antes de la cantidad de tiempo o del periodo de tiempo que estamos hablando. ¿Sí? Por una semana, por 10 días, por 5 años, ¿ok? Maybe you can say for 2 weeks, for 5 days, for 5 years, for 6 months, por el periodo que ustedes decidan. No se olviden que for va a ir antes del número del periodo que ustedes están hablando. Meanwhile, mientras tanto, ¿sí? Mientras tanto, también lo podemos utilizar para hablar de tiempo o englobar un periodo de tiempo. For example, meanwhile, Gran stayed in Canada and Granddad went back to England. ¿Sí? Mientras tanto, la abuelita se quedó en Canadá y el abuelito tuvo que regresar a Inglaterra. And then we have, I used to visit them over the summer. Over y después va a ir un periodo de tiempo. En este caso, miren, over a year podría ser por un año. ¿Sí? Over the summer, por el verano, por el tiempo de, o los meses del verano. Over winter could be also, or over the holidays. ¿Sí? Por las vacaciones, por el verano, por el invierno. Este over también nos permite a nosotros como hablar sobre un periodo de tiempo. Now, can you be a little bit more observative, be more careful? Watch this 6 sentences and help me completing the rules. Ayúdenme a completar las reglas. Here we have 5 rules. Tenemos 5 reglas. The first one says, we can use while or during before a noun or a noun phrase. ¿Qué creen ustedes? Podemos utilizar while o during antes de un sustantivo o una frase con sustantivo. ¿Cuál se utiliza antes de un sustantivo?
Weren't.
What would it be?
During.
Okay.
During,
me dicen while. Okay, let me see. The right answer would be during. Yes, that's right. So the right answer would be during in this case. Let me just highlight the answer. Vamos a resaltar La respuesta, ok? So we can use during, before, and now. Vamos a ocupar esta palabra during antes de un sustantivo o una frase con un sustantivo. What about the next? We can use while or during before a verb phrase. A verb phrase.
While.
Mm-hmm. While va a ir antes del verbo, ¿no? O de una frase con un verbo. Miren, aquí teníamos was working, ¿no? Es una frase con verbos. Tenemos verbo to be y el verbo working con ing. What about the next? We can or we cannot use during before lengths of time. ¿Podemos o no podemos utilizar during antes de periodos largos de tiempo? Por ejemplo, 6 meses. ¿Se puede o no se puede? What do you think? We can or can't use during before lengths of time?
Can't.
Can't. Thank you, Kevin. Yes, we can't, right? We can't use, no utilizamos. Cuando ustedes van a utilizar during, ustedes no utilizan por ahí 6 months, 5 years. No, no es cierto. During no va con periodos tan largos de tiempo. ¿Sí? What about the next, number 4? Meanwhile or over means at the same time and is always at the start of a sentence. ¿Cuál de estas dos palabritas, meanwhile or over, significa en ese tiempo? Y se utiliza al inicio de la oración. Which one?
Meanwhile
siempre va a ir al inicio de una oración, ¿sí? Mientras tanto, en ese momento, ¿sí? Meanwhile. The microphones, guys. And the last rule we have over here, meanwhile or over, can mean the same as during. ¿Cuál de las dos significa lo mismo que durante? Over or while?
Over,
exactly. So, over, it's going to mean the same as during. Sí, significa o tiene un significado muy parecido a durante, ¿no? Durante el verano, durante el invierno, o por el verano, o por el invierno. So, over can have the same meaning as during. Thank you, guys. So, with this knowledge, you can help me completing the exercise from the next part, okay? So can you help me underlining the correct words over here? In number 1, for example, I lived alone from and until, what would you use?
From.
Exactly. En la primera sería from, ¿no es cierto? Vivía solo desde 1993, from 1993. Y en la segunda opción, ¿qué elegirían? From
until,
exactly.
Until
I got married, right? So I lived alone from 1993. Until I got married, ¿sí? Vivía solo desde el 93 hasta que me casé. Let's move to the next one. Number 2, I work as a chef. What do you think? While or during?
During.
Okay. So I work as a chef during the 90s, right? So let me just choose the right option. Okay, let's move to number three. I usually go abroad over or from the winter months.
Over,
exactly.
Over.
Over the winter months, durante los meses de invierno. Number four, I lived in London while or meanwhile. I was working for the government.
Why?
While. Vivía en Londres mientras trabajaba para el gobierno. And number five, I had a job in Los Angeles. From or for about?
Or for about.
For about 2 years. Y tuve un trabajo en Los Ángeles por 2 años. Luego, ¿qué elegirían? Meanwhile or while?
Meanwhile.
Meanwhile. I was planning to move to New York. Okay, no se olviden que el meanwhile va siempre al inicio de una oración. Meanwhile, I was planning to move to New York. Thank you. Now, can you help me completing these 5 sentences over here? He was a soldier in the army. ¿Con qué completaríamos esta?
Four.
Exactly. So we have 4 or 5 years. Let's move to number two. Oops. He went to India twice.
While,
exactly. Tenemos un verbo después, ¿no es cierto? Entonces nos queda muy bien while. While he was working on the boat. Number three, he was in Italy.
From.
Exactly. From 1943 until 1945. Number four, she was in Rome for about 6 months.
Meanwhile,
exacto. Mucho ojo en ese punto, ¿no? Si hay un punto y empieza otra oración, podemos ocupar meanwhile. Meanwhile, her husband stayed in Milan. And the last one, number five, from 1950.
Until.
Okay. Until, tenemos from, and until. From 1950 until 2 years later, he worked as a chef in an Italian restaurant. Exactly, guys. Thank you so much. So pay attention, take notes, maybe make a screenshot if you need it. Of these words, and when do we use these words? When we are telling a story, okay? So, mucho ojo, porque estas 6 palabritas, 6, 7 palabritas que acabamos de revisar, las van a ocupar ustedes en este momento. Okay, so pay attention, take a picture or write them down because you're going to need it now. What are you going to do, guys? We're going with, or we're moving to our written part of the lesson. This time you're going to help me writing. Vamos a escribir algo esta vez. What you will write, guys, is a short biography about a family member. Okay, so you're going to write a biography of someone you know, or about someone you know there, or it's very close to you. Mainly, to make it a little bit easier, choose a member of the family, okay? So try to write a biography of someone you know well. It can be your mother, it can be your grandfather, your grandmother, maybe one of your uncles or one of your aunts, it doesn't matter. Just write a biography of someone you know. It can be a family member, okay? A family member. Let me write over here. Let me write a family member. And for you to make it easier or to know what to write, think about these three questions over here. Sí, para que sea un poco más fácil para ustedes saber qué poner en la biografía, pueden guiarse en estas tres preguntas. You can be guided by these three questions. Why this person is important to you? Okay, so maybe you can write something about why is this person important to you? What do you remember the most about this person? Y lo que se acuerden más o lo que ustedes recuerden más de esta persona. And what are the key events in this people or in this person's life? Okay, ¿cuáles serían como que los puntos clave o los sucesos claves en la vida de esta persona? For example, if you're talking about your grandparents, maybe you can say, in 1999, he got married, right? Se casó en tal año mientras trabajaba en tal ciudad, qué sé yo. Compró su primer carro, o tuvo su primer hijo, o se cambió de ciudad. Sí, van a ir como dándonos un poco de la historia de la vida de esa persona. That would be a biography, ¿sí? Una pequeña biografía de esa persona. So, where do you have to write? Where are you going to write a biography? I'm going to share with you a link. So you can start with your biography or writing a biography. Give me a second and I will share with you the link. Okay, so I have some extra information, so I'm going to share that with you. Let me change screen. Okay, here you have, look at this, the same as I was telling you before. Write a biography of someone you know well from your family. Use the words to describe a time while telling a story. No se olviden de escribir las palabras o de utilizar las palabras que acabamos de ver para hablar o describir el tiempo. ¿Sí? While, meanwhile, during, over, etc., etc. To make it easier, you can think about the next thing, the next things, so you can include them in your biography. Sí, pueden pensar en esas preguntas para el momento en el que ustedes estén o decidan escribir su biografía. I'm going to share with you now the link of the Padlet, so you can start writing. Can you tell me if you got the link? Can you see the link on the chat box, guys? Did you get the link? ¿Les llegó el link?
Yes.
Okay, guys. So you can start writing in Padlet. Don't forget that you need to write in real time. I'm watching you guys. If someone just come up with something like pop up from nowhere, I will know that you were using maybe a translator. So please, guys, try to write in real time. Vamos escribiendo en tiempo real su biography. For this activity, guys, you have 15 minutes para ir escribiendo la biografía de alguien que conozcan bien. Don't forget to write your names exactly. Thank you, Bibi. No se olviden de escribir sus nombres. So I know who's writing who's participating. Thank you. Thank you, Bibi. Thank you, Bane. Asu, excellent. So guys, your 15 minutes start now. Empiezan ya sus 15 minutos. Good luck, everyone. And don't forget you to write the biography of someone you know well from your family. ¿Sí? La biografía de alguien que sepan bien de su familia. De su mamá, de su abuelita, de su abuelito, de algún tío, de alguna tía, alguien que ustedes conozcan bien. You can take the picture and upload to classwork number 10. Sí, los que ya terminaron pueden tomar su foto y subir la evidencia como classwork número 10. Y los que no, los que todavía están terminando de escribir, you have 5 extra minutes to complete. Tienen 5 minutitos más para terminar. Ah, por ahí se me perdió. Estaba leyendo un... Paola Valdivieso. What I remember the most... No te olvides de poner el artículo de antes de most. Paola Valdivieso. What I remember the most about him is...
Sure, I'm sorry. The punctuation in my classwork is because I'm in my cell phone. I don't have all the tools for do it well. I try to do it all in my cell phone.
Okay, Daniel, thank you for the explanation. Don't worry. This time you will do it in Padlet. Next time you will write by hand. So don't worry. Thank you, thank you. As I can see that some of you are still completing. Excellent, Aldrich. You used a lot the words to describe the time. Carlita, my granddad is the most important person for me. ¿Sí? Iría the most important y después va la palabra person. Exactly. The most important person for me. Okay. Excellent, guys. I can see some interesting stories. Four. Vane, sí, por ahí tienes el four también, que estás utilizando for 35 years, que podrías ponerle en negritas. While they lived in Ibarra also. Yes, I can see that you are using very well the words that we were learning ahead. So don't forget to take the picture and upload the evidence, guys. No se olviden de ir subiendo la evidencia. Paul, tenemos ahí un there que está sin mayúscula. No te olvides de la capital letter después de un punto. Y ahí dice, I had her own baby. Tú tuviste el bebé de ella. A eso más o menos se refiere, ¿no? ¿No es cierto? She had her own baby. She had, estamos hablando de... yes, she had her own baby. The same, and I think, estás hablando de tu mami, ¿no es cierto? Luego, después podrías poner, the business was not going well, and she had to close it. Estamos hablando de alguien más, no de ti. Después dices, yes, until she met. Mm-hmm. Exactly. Excellent. Okay, guys, let me check your who has uploaded the classwork so I can be sure of your work, okay? Let me see. Remember that you can upload a picture or maybe a PDF, whatever works better for you. So let me check. I have some of your evidence. I have the evidence of, let me see. Alexis, I have the evidence of Wendy. I have the evidence of Kevin, of, I don't know how Jason got the link because he's not in the class, so he's not going to get the whole grade. Todos sus compañeros que no se conecten a la clase en vivo y entreguen el trabajo, tienen menos nota, ¿no? Por si acaso. Por ahí veo chicos que no están en clase y que han presentado el trabajo. Tengo la evidencia de Aldrich, tengo la evidencia de Pau Valdivieso. Sigan subiendo, chicos, la evidencia. You have just 5 minutes to complete with the evidence. Nos quedan solo 5 minutos para subir la evidencia. For next week, guys, what do you have to do for next week? Listen carefully. Vamos a ver qué tenemos para la siguiente clase, así que pongan mucha atención y escuchen con atención. Next week we have, let me check on your calendar. We are on June. Next Tuesday, guys, you have the written part of your exam, okay? Siguiente clase, parte escrita del examen de medio semestre. Llegamos ya a medio semestre. Es decir, que la siguiente semana vamos a estar con examen. 22 y 24, es decir, martes y jueves de la siguiente semana, ustedes van a tener su examen de medio semestre. El día martes ustedes van a rendir el examen de medio semestre, la parte escrita. Y el jueves le estarán dando la parte oral, es decir, el speaking. So, get ready for your midterm exam. Vayan alistándose para el examen de medio semestre. Significa que debemos estudiar unidades de la 1 a la 3. ¿Sí? Study units from 1 to 3. And also, you need to have completed the 3 units in your Cambridge platform, okay? Necesitamos que las 3 unidades de la plataforma de Cambridge estén completas. ¿Sí? Es decir, que para el siguiente martes debemos ya contar con, primero estudiar de las unidades de la 1 a la 3, ¿sí? Y también les puede servir como una forma de estudio tener completo las 3 unidades en la plataforma de Cambridge. ¿Sí? No se olviden que ustedes deben realizar la parte de extension, academic skills, tenemos el online workbook, ¿sí? Y las, en el assessment, las unit progress test. Okay, guys, let me check once again the evidence that you have uploaded.